Good morning. I think I've read somewhere how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And apparently that's what's going on this morning. A lot of conversation, a lot of fellowship, but we enjoy that. We enjoy visitors. We have visitors with us this morning. We had a great work day yesterday. A lot of people showed up to help with the building and to prove that we actually did something. I just found out there's some tape or something right up here behind me on the edge of the baptistry. Dave Schulte is trying to get me to jump up there and get it, but I didn't decide not to do that. If you haven't seen the baptistry, it is wonderful. We had some guys paint that and it has to dry for a while and everything, but it is really, really looking good. Thank you for everybody that helped with that and everything else that was done here at the building yesterday. We are completely done, no more work to do, and I am not telling the truth, unfortunately. There's still work to be done, so I'm sure we'll have some more days later on. Let me make a few announcements. You're visiting again, we're glad to have you, and I hope you'll fill out a visitor's card and give it to one of us or put it somewhere where we can pick that up and get to know you, stay around a little bit too. Elders and deacons meeting this afternoon at 4:30. Bread of Life is taking up items for first aid kits this quarter. Information and description of items needed are in the bulletin and in the daily updates. Sign-up sheet for Central Youth Retreat and at Big Reedy on Friday through Sunday, December 9th through 11th, are on the Youth Bulletin Board. And there's a card given by John and Teresa Henderson. It's in Cherry's tray out there, and it'll be in the bulletin probably next week. If you would, bow with me for a second. We'll open with prayer. Father, we are so thankful to be your children. We're thankful to be members here at Central, be part of this family. We know that in each household, there's probably issues and challenges that need to be addressed, that people are dealing with. We pray that you'd be with each of us as we try to help each other to make our way through this life and help each other get to heaven. Be with us today, this morning, especially as we worship you. We pray that our worship and our life will be acceptable in your sight. Forgive us where we fail, we pray in Jesus' name.
As we prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, we'll sing number 343, number 343, Ivory Palaces. The words of this song talk about Christ coming from the ivory palaces down to live upon this cruel world, and beautiful words are in here. My Lord has garments of wondrous fine and made their texture fills. Its fragrance reach to this heart of mine with joy. Out of the ivory palaces into a world of gold, only his great eternal life had all, so his sorrow sore, for aloes had a blood. And when I think of the cross he bore, my eyes with tear dry. Out of the ivory palaces into a world of woe, only His great eternal love. In garments glorious He will come to open wide the door, and I shall enter my heavenly home to dwell. Out of the ivory palaces into a world of woe, only His great eternal love.
This morning, as we focus around the table, I'll be reading from Romans chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. If you need a packet, please raise your hand high, and Nate will bring you one. Romans chapter 8, verse 31 says, "What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?" I think many times, especially myself, we don't grasp the totality of that verse. If the God of the universe, who created the universe, is for us, who can be against us? Nobody. Verse 32 says, "He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall we not with him also freely give us all things?" So if God gave us Jesus and spared not his own son, is there anything God will not give us? Absolutely not. Look at verse 35. "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us." Look at verse 38. "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." There's only one thing that's going to separate us from the love of Jesus, and that's ourselves, which if that happens would be a very sad condition. So just as God loves us and spared not his son, Jesus also loved us enough to give his life. So let's focus our minds on the cross as we pray for the bread. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful and so privileged that we can surround this table upon the first day of the week. Father, help us to remember that great sacrifice that Christ made for all of us. As we partake of the loaf, let us remember Christ's body upon that cross. And we pray, Father, that we may partake of the loaf in a manner pleasing unto thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue our focus on the cross as we give thanks for the cup. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we once and again come to you in prayer with thanksgiving in our heart. Father, we're thankful for this cup which symbolizes Christ's shed blood on the cross. Father, we realize without that shedding of blood, there'd be no remission of sins. And we pray, Father, as we partake of this cup, we will focus on the cross and that great sacrifice that Christ made. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We also have an opportunity to give back to the Lord as he has so richly blessed us. You can give online, or there's a box in the back that you can give. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you have blessed us so much. We have so many blessings, and often we take those blessings for granted. Help us to realize, Father, that these blessings that we so richly enjoy come from Thee. We're thankful for the ways and means we have to provide for ourselves and our families. And Father, as we give back to Thee, we pray that we will do so with a cheerful heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's good to have everybody here today. Got a good attendance, so we're going to have some good singing, I'm sure, today. Our first song is number 213, number 213. He gave me a song, and we have a strong bass lead on the chorus. So let's, those who are singing bass, please sing out. Will you please stand for this song, all three verses?
He took my burdens all away unto a rider digging your song. A wonderful song, a wonderful song I now can sing in my heart joy that holds me. He gave me a song, a wonderful song. A song.
He gave me a song
to sing about.
To sing about.
He lifted me.
He lifted me.
Once in and now.
Once in and now.
Praise His name. And as my King. A wonderful song. It is to me. Right the way goes every day, walking the heavenly way. He gave me a song, a wonderful song. A wonderful song I now can sing. Praise to Him, my King. He gave me a song, a wonderful song.
He gave me a song. He gave me a song.
To sing about.
To sing about.
He lifted me.
He lifted me.
Once in and out.
Once in and out.
Praise His name. There is my King. A wonderful song. He is to me. Needing no more to die, never to say goodbye. He gave me a song, a wonderful song. And some of these days in that fair land, sing with a chorus friend. He gave me a song, a wonderful song.
He gave me a song.
To sing about,
to sing about.
He lifted me,
he lifted me.
Once in and out,
once in and out.
Oh, praise His name. There's my King. A wonderful song. It is to me.
The song before our prayer, scripture reading and prayer today is number 252, I Am a Poor Wayfaring Stranger. All three verses.
I am a poor wayfaring stranger, while traveling through this world of hope, yet there's no sickness beyond danger to that bright land to which I go. I'm going there to see my Father. dwelling there, no more to roam. I only go, wing over Jordan. I only go, wing over home. I know dark clouds and steep, but cold and fierce lie out before me, where God's redeemed shall ever sleep. I'm going there to see my Father. I'm going there, no more. Wing over Jordan, I'm only going over home. I'll soon be free from every trial. My body sleep in the churchyard. I'll drop the cross. My great reward. I'm going there to see my Father. I'm going to be praised forevermore. I'm only going, wing over Jordan. I'm only.
I will be reading 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things.
Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful this day that you've blessed us with to gather here and worship you. Pray, Father, that the things we do will glorify you and please you. Thank you for Gary and his ability to lead us in song. We pray that the songs that we sing will be pleasing to thy ear and warm our hearts. Thank you, Father, for loving us. Thank you for providing salvation for us. Father, we thank you so much for the ministers that preach here. Bless them. May they always encourage us to follow thee down that path, that narrow path that will lead to you. Father, we pray that we might have a home with thee in heaven one day. We thank you so much for the greatest gift that you could give us through your Son, Jesus. We pray that your mercy, your grace, your wisdom, your strength be upon us and forgive us, Father, for we do fail you. Go with us the rest of this hour. Bless us. Continue to bless us as you always have. And it's in Christ we pray. Amen.
If you're using a hymn book today, we may want to go ahead and mark your song of invitation, which is number 237, number 237. And before our lesson today, we will sing Angry Words, number 37, all three verses. Angry words, oh, let them ever from the tongue unbridled slip. May the heart face him forever.
for this loyal heart live. Love one another, that's the Savior. Children obey the Father's blessed command. Love one another, that's the Savior. Children obey the blessed command. Love is not to pure and holy. Friendship is sacred bar. For a moment, reckless folly, the heart has holy and marred. Love one another, thus in the Savior. Children obey the Father's blessed command. Love one another, thus in the Savior. Children obey the blessed command. Angry words are lightly spoken, bitterest thoughts are rashly stirred. Brightly a life are broken by a single angry word. Love one another, thus in the Savior. Children obey the Father's blessed command. Love one another, thus in the Savior. Children obey the blessed command.
Isn't it wonderful to be here this morning? Okay, four of you think it's great to be here. Isn't it wonderful to be here this morning? It's been great. Singing has been wonderful. We have a good number this morning. A lot of visitors, guests with us this morning. And for everyone who is here, we are so very, very thankful. We did have a good work day yesterday. Some of us showed off new talents. My wife can lay flooring. I learned that yesterday. David Graziano learned that I have no idea how to do any electricity, but I can hold stuff. I'm really good at holding stuff in the air. But we had just a wonderful, wonderful day. I almost walked up here and just pulled the tape off. But then I realized if I did, I'd probably rip my coat or something, and so that'd be really bad. Or if I didn't reach it, how embarrassing would that be? It took a frenetic style of play, and it took something that the crowd could almost not believe. If you've been to a basketball game, maybe a middle school game or high school game, you may have noticed that the scoreboards on gyms have three numbers for the score. But you may have never noticed the first one is always a 1. The second two are 8s because you can form every number, the 0, the 1, the 2, the 3, out of those 8s. But the first one is a 1. 30 years ago, that was tested. In a small university in South Alabama, Troy State University, they played a small school. And at that time, Troy State played a style of basketball where their whole goal was to shoot as many three-pointers as possible and basically play no defense. Their whole goal was to let you score so they could come down and quickly shoot a three-pointer to outscore you 3 points for 2. And they played a very small school 30 years ago. And the crowd began to realize something odd was happening. But what was interesting was when the game was over and the picture it's getting ready to show up was blurry because it was 30 years ago. There wasn't Google back then as much. But the scoreboard read that they had lost 141-58. There was only one problem. They hadn't lost the game. They had actually rolled the scoreboard over and won 258-141. What made the news was this ridiculously high-scoring game, but also the way it was reported in several places was that Troy State had broken the scoreboard. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we're introduced to that beautiful concept of love. Nate read it so well for us a few minutes ago. It's a passage most of us know very, very well. But in that passage, you have a lot of descriptions, a lot of difficult things for us to follow. And we're going to think this morning about just one of them. But before we do that, I want to take a moment to remind us that when we see 1 Corinthians 13 and think, okay, there's going to be a sermon about this particular chapter, it's going to be a sermon on marriage. No, it's not. Or maybe it's going to be a lesson about parenting or dealing with the home. No, it's not. Because if you put 1 Corinthians 13 back into its context, it really flows from chapter 12 through chapter 14. That's all one large context. Where the Apostle Paul was writing those Christians at Corinth about dealing with specifically miraculous spiritual gifts. And really, chapter 12 tells us they had the problem with them. Chapter 14 tells us really how to regulate them, or them how to regulate them. But then in the middle, in what we know is the 13th chapter, he gives them what he calls at the end of chapter 12 a more excellent way. And that more excellent way is the way of the kind of love that's described in those verses in the middle portion of that chapter. And so this is a lesson for all of us. Because in context, 1 Corinthians 13 is dealing with Christians dealing with one another, getting along with one another, specifically in Corinth concerning spiritual gifts, but for all of us, simply getting along with one another as Christians. There are times, because we are people, that we will struggle with this. But how we deal with it matters. And we're not going to look at that whole list this morning. In fact, we're only going to look at one thing. One of those descriptions found in those verses. In the English Standard Version, it's found at the end of verse 5. The end of verse 5 reads, "It is not irritable or resentful." But if you're reading from an English Standard Version this morning, you may notice that behind that word resentful, there's a little notation for a footnote. And the footnote is what's interesting. Because the footnote states, "It is not irritable or does not count up wrongdoing." Some other translations translate that phrase in this way. The King James Version has that love thinketh no evil. The New American Standard Bible has love does not keep an account of a wrong suffered. The American Standard Version from 1901 has that love taketh not account of evil. Now I wanted to share all those with you because you see a theme running through all of them. There's two themes, really. One of simply thinking, but the other you may know some things about counting or accounting. And that's really the idea behind the word. The word that Paul used, I'm going to bring it up here and bring it up again at the end of our time, is the word logizomai. I'm not saying it sounds smart. It's because you know some words that come from that word. It's where we get our word logic from. Logizomai. Logic. To think through some things. And so when the King James Version, for example, has thinketh no evil, that is literally translating the phrase. What's interesting is that that word was very often used in realms like mathematics and accounting and those sorts of things. Because to be in those worlds, you really do have to think through things. If you're an accountant and you make a mistake in step 2, it's going to affect step 17. And accountants really do think through things. I wonder how I know that. When accountants put their numbers on the board, and they're perfectly lined up for everyone to know. But accountants really have to think through. Mathematicians really have to think through, because if I make a mistake here, it's going to affect way on down the road in this long problem that all of our high school students are going, please don't bring up math in a sermon. But love doesn't do that toward wrong. I want us to think about that concept this morning under three ideas. I want us to think about the reasons behind this description. Then I want us to think about the reality of this description. And we'll think about the reflection of the description. And all of that under the title of Love's Non-Working Scoreboard. Because love says the scoreboard here is broken. Number one, consider the reasons behind this particular command. You know, when you're dealing with people, even fellow Christians, and sometimes situations get heated, situations get difficult, sometimes people begin to become historical. Notice I didn't say hysterical. Sometimes that happens too. But they begin to become historical. What I mean by that is, because the temperature and the situation is going up, I begin to remember everything you've ever done against me that's wrong, and I've had it the ready for just this moment. I know everything you've ever done against me, against my family, against anyone else, and so now when you make a mistake, or now you say the wrong thing, or now you do the wrong thing, I've got this huge long list of things I'm just ready to unload on you to prove that I'm right and you're wrong, and to put myself ahead of the situation, or whatever it is. 1 Corinthians 13 makes it clear that is not how Christians treat one another. We just don't. I may remember those things, but they're not on the scoreboard. And there's a lot of reasons why that should be true. But let me share with you four. First of all, is because it's commanded. If you're taking notes, you might just put, it's described. In other words, the most obvious thing to consider is, it's here in 1 Corinthians 13. Yeah, this list in 1 Corinthians 13, this description of love, is so well known to us that I don't know about you, but sometimes I can be tempted to think, you know what, I get most of the stuff on that list right. So surely God didn't mean for me to get all of it right. I mean, if I get, you know, 90% of the things on that list right, patient and kind and get some of those things, then there's two or three that surely he'll overlook. But the point he's trying to make in giving us this lengthy description, one, is that this isn't easy, but also that all of this comes under the umbrella of what it means to be a loving person. It's not pick and choose. It's not just do the easy ones and forget the hard ones. It's to make certain that I'm doing my best to fulfill all of them. So if I don't have this kind of mindset, if I am keeping score, if I am making sure that I hold against someone everything they've done is wrong for me, I am not fulfilling this command or this description, but also it builds us up individually. I can't be everything that I'm supposed to be as a Christian if I'm keeping up with everything that someone else has done wrong to me. It's a different context, and I know that. But in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 15, there's a phrase that just, I need to remember it and I need to live it more often. Where the writer of Hebrews talks about the root or the roots, depending on the translation you have, of bitterness. Wow, is that a powerful picture? The root of bitterness. You can get that picture in your mind, can't you? Those things that deal with our mind, our thinking, that just begin to take root in our heart and our soul. And if we don't remove those things, they begin to take more control, begin to put down more roots, as it were. They begin to take over our thinking and the way we look at people and the way we look at other things. And I cannot fully be everything I'm supposed to be as a Christian if these heart sins, if you will, unforgiveness, bitterness, grudges, whatever it is, just keep putting roots down in my soul. But if I will allow God to remove those things and I'll work on keeping those things out, I am more likely to stay faithful. Also, a reason for this command is it builds unity. If when I see that Christian, you know the one, and I'll just go the other way, thank you very much, every time, is that building up the body of Christ? Now, there are going to be people, obviously, we're closer to than others. That's just the nature of being people. In a congregation this large, I'm going to have people who are closer friends, as it were. That's understandable. Stage of life, interests, those things are part of it. But I do not get to pick and choose which ones I treat like brothers and sisters and which ones I don't. We must be sure that we're working on the unity among all believers, or we're not what God told us to be. And then also, a reason for this command, is it provides focus. If you can keep your finger in 1 Corinthians 13, flip over just a few pages to Philippians chapter 4. So I want you to see this passage in Philippians 4 verses 2 and 3, where Paul is writing about a couple of Christian ladies in the church there at Philippi. And in Philippians chapter 4 verses 2 and 3, he writes this: "I entreat Euodia and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life." Now, there's whole sermons in those couple of verses. And no, I have no idea what Euodia and Syntyche were dealing with. I don't know. But notice the tenses found in those verses. They have labored with me, Paul says. They had done things that were good. But now what's Paul having to do in the present? He's having to tell this church, basically, you tell them to get along. Why? Because whatever the situation was between them, they lost their focus. Paul has to take time and energy and ink and all this stuff to tell these women to make sure they get along when they have been doing things where he could say that they were faithful. They helped in the ministry, but now they got to get along. When I'm struggling to get along with a fellow Christian, when I'm keeping up with everything they've done that's wrong, I'm going to be less evangelistic. I'm going to be less encouraging to other people. I'm not going to work on unity. In other words, the priorities of what God would have us to be begin to go far down the list because I'm focused on something I shouldn't be focused on in the first place. Are there other reasons why this description is important? Yeah, but I think these four show us it's vital to having this kind of love. So with that said, turn to the reality of it. And the reality is very, very simple. The reality is it's hard. It's hard, but it's doable. And it is difficult. Anyone who would say, oh, this is the easiest one on the list. I wish you'd ever preached this sermon instead of me. Because this is hard. We remember the pain. We remember maybe the embarrassment of a situation. We remember what was said or not said. We remember what was done or not done. We remember those things. And that's just part of it. Because we're human, we remember all the difficulties that surround or strain this particular relationship and this particular situation. But just because something is hard does not mean I get to avoid attempting to work on it. That's why Paul describes it here. Remember, John would tell us that God's commands are not burdensome or not grievous. And sometimes we think, wait a minute, some of them are. Not if I've got the right kind of heart. Doesn't mean I'm not going to work on it. Doesn't mean I'm not going to fail at times. But it means that my life is freer when I am working on those things and improving on those things. Some people hear a sermon like this and think, this is just pie in the sky. This is impossible. No. It's hard, but it's not impossible. Now, what makes this possible? In other words, what makes it possible to be able to not have a scoreboard? It's a two-letter word found in verse 5. It. It is not irritable or resentful because of what that it stands for. My mom taught English. It is a pronoun. You proud, Mom? Good. Okay. It is a pronoun. What's the noun? Love or charity, King James Version. But here's what we haven't talked about yet in this lesson. And that is what kind of love is being described in 1 Corinthians 13. Because all throughout this chapter are forms of that famous word agape or agapao. We sometimes describe that love as being a love that's self-sacrificial, a love that wants the ultimate best for the other person. And you put that in this context, you put that in this description, and even that brings out more meaning. When you have agape love and it's self-sacrificial, what does that mean as far as not keeping a scoreboard? It means that I know what someone did that was wrong. I remember those things. But I'm sacrificing any quote-unquote advantage those things give me. I'm not going to use them against that person. I'm not going to make sure people see that I'm better in the situation. No. But it also means that love seeks the ultimate good of the other person. And we never need to forget the ultimate good is that that person goes to heaven. It's not just that our relationship is stronger here or a relationship is reconciled here. That's important. And we need to be working on that constantly. But I will not do anything, hopefully, if I'm a Christian, that would cause that person to begin to question God or begin to have more strained relationships with other Christians that would then harm their soul even further. Agape love means I'm going to go down the scoreboard if I have to, so that person can get it right. And when you think about that, it brings up a three-letter word, but, and it's usually followed by two other words, what about? Because it's easy to stand up here and talk in theory. In other words, here's some generalities, here's some biblical concepts, some philosophical concepts. But what about my situation? What about this situation? Or in some general ways, think about these. What about if they do it again? Didn't Jesus have something to say about that? And Peter asked him a question. If I can paraphrase, Peter basically said, what if I'm so righteous that seven times I forgive somebody a day? And Jesus basically said, 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 5. Because he basically said, don't have a mathematical formula. Not seven times, 77 times, or 70 times seven, depending on the translation you've got. In other words, this isn't a math problem. I need to be ready to forgive. Yeah, but okay, Adam, I get that, and I have. But what about if they don't repent? That's hard stuff, isn't it? It's not an easy answer. And I know what Jesus said, if he repents, you forgive him. I get that. And I believe that. I believe that's my stance is to forgive when someone repents. But here's what we sometimes do with that intellectually or psychologically. Because I know what Jesus said, if he repents, forgive him. What I will do is I will basically stay as far away from that person as possible, and I'll even put down broken glass between that person and me so it makes it harder for them to come to me asking for repentance. That is not biblical either. What's biblical is I need to work on me constantly. So if that day ever comes, or when that day comes, when that person does repent, I stand ready to say, you're forgiven. But what about if they said they repented and they didn't really? In other words, what if they said the words, but nothing changed? I need to be very, very, very careful about reading the motives of other people. Now, there are biblical concepts about fruits worthy of repentance. I get that. But if I begin to say, I know what they said, but they didn't mean it. Do I really know that? And I also need to think about some other things that are found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 in this very same description. Remember at the end of what Nate read a few minutes ago? Things like love thinks the best or thinks all things. Love hopes all things. The idea is that love thinks the best of somebody else. Do I really think the best of my brothers and sisters in Christ? Do I really believe the best about my brothers and sisters in Christ? And you also begin to turn that around and think about the idea that God forgave me and I've messed up many times since then. And I'm sure glad he doesn't question my motives. Is this easy? No. But by putting it in Scripture, God is telling us this is possible. It can be done. And when it is, that brings about the reflection. And the reflection is what it means to do this. Oh, you say, well, if I do this, what I'm doing is I'm fulfilling this list found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And that's true to some degree, but folks, it's way deeper than that. It is way deeper than just fulfilling some list found in a beautiful chapter. Because what really happens when I fulfill this description is I'm reflecting the nature of God. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 32, the same writer, the Apostle Paul, would tell Christians, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another. How? As God in Christ has also forgiven you. Don't lose sight of that little word as. As God in Christ has also forgiven you. Now, that obviously is tying the fact that we simply forgive one another with the fact that God has forgiven us. But also don't lose sight of the fact the word as means in the same manner as. When God forgave you, it went off the scoreboard. And the Bible goes out of its way to make sure we understand that. In Isaiah chapter 38 and verse 17, God would talk about taking sins and casting them behind His back. In Micah chapter 7 and verse 2, He would talk about taking our sins and casting them into the depths of the ocean or the depths of the sea. In the 103rd Psalm, in verse 12, God would talk about our sins being as far away from Him as the east is from the west. And if we don't understand any of those word pictures, He says it very plainly in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12 when He says, their sins and their iniquities, I will remember what? No more. No more. This is the Almighty, infinite, all-knowing God, basically, if I may reverently say, Him saying, I don't know what you're talking about. If He would do that for me, what right do I have not to do that for a brother or sister in Christ? As God in Christ has forgiven you. When I am able to do that, I am reflecting as best I can the forgiving nature of God. In that description of 1 Corinthians 13, you have the phrase that love does not keep account of wrong, love thinks no evil. And I think it's very significant that Paul uses a word there that has to do with thinking about things. And here's why I say that. Because when I've been wronged, or you've been wronged, if we're not thinking clearly, here's what often happens. We begin to think about the person who's harmed us, who's hurt us, who's sinned against us, and we start also building a narrative around what they've done. We know the offense that they've done, but we also begin to think, well, here's why they did it. And here's probably somebody they've told about it. And here's what other things they'll probably do in the future. And what ends up happening is we've built something around the sin or the offense that may or may not be true, but that then makes it far harder for that person ever to seek reconciliation for us, because they not only have to ask forgiveness for what they've done, but for the things we've accused them of doing or we think that they've done. And that is a very dark place to live. But the Apostle Paul uses the word logizomai. Think through this thoroughly. How do I do that? In light of Scripture. One, is what they've done actually a sin? Or is it just a mistake? Is it just a slight? Is it just a misunderstanding? Because sometimes we want to elevate those things to the level of sin just because it hurts us, right? I need to make sure, is this actually a sin or not? But then also, am I putting more on that person or those people than what they've actually done? Or am I thinking through this thoroughly in light of Scripture so that when they come to me and say, you know what, I was wrong, I simply look at them and say, I don't know what you're talking about. Because that's what God did for you. But our mindset is, they've wronged me, I'm going to wrong them. I'm going to make it harder on them. Here's the scoreboard. And I'm going to make sure I'm always ahead. If you have that mindset with any Christian this morning, let me issue this challenge. Instead of trying to settle the score, destroy the scoreboard. Destroy it. Because this is not about me being ahead of someone else. Me being quote-unquote better than someone else. This is about all of us going to heaven. And I won't go there if I'm keeping score. And I want to go there more than anything in this life. Preachers sometimes say that they write sermons for themselves, and if you can learn something from it, that's great. That's true. Never, never has that been more true of me than this one. Because this is hard. This is so hard. But praise God, it's possible. I never want to have any Christian look at me and think, I wonder what he thinks I've done wrong. Instead, I want every brother and sister in Christ to be able to look at every other brother and sister in Christ and say, I don't know what you're talking about. You're my brother. You're my sister. And I'm not taking your scoreboard to zero. I'm destroying it. Because that's what God did for me. Has he done that for you? He's told you the very simple things to do in order to have that scoreboard destroyed between you and him. He's told you to believe that Jesus is the Son of God. He's told you to repent of sins. Unless you repent, you'll perish. Luke chapter 13 and verse 3. He's told you to confess Jesus as the Son of God. And he's told you to be baptized, immersed in water. And at that point, sins are washed away. Acts 2:38, Mark 16:16, and many other passages. If you've never done that, we can take care of that this morning. Or maybe you as a Christian haven't been living in a way that's described by 1 Corinthians 13 or elsewhere in the New Testament. And you realize, you know what, I can't go to heaven like that. And you want us to pray for your forgiveness or your encouragement or strength. Whatever your need is, will you come while we stand and sing to encourage you?
He is the grace of the Savior for sinners like me. Sin from the Father, and it thrills my soul. Just to feel and to know that His blood. His grace, which is great, yes, His grace reaches deep and will last through eternal day. Now I'm under His control. Just to know that His grace reaches me. Higher than the mountain and brighter than the sun, it was offered at Calvary forever. Greatest of treasures, and it's mine today. Though my sins were as scarlet, He has washed them away. His grace reaches me, yes, His grace reaches me and the last will be forever. Now I'm under this control and I'm happy in my soul just to know that His grace reaches me.
Be seated, please.
Rebecca Bass has responded this morning. She has been visiting with us for a couple of weeks now, and she's been talking to some of us, texting some of us. And she texted me, I believe it was on Friday, and just told me that she knew something wasn't right with her life. She wasn't sure what it was exactly. She knew it wasn't right with God. She has all kinds of difficulties in a lot of ways. And she wants us to pray with her. And I asked her, you know, specifically, what do you want us to pray? And folks, this is beautiful. She said, I know about baptism and those sort of things. But she said, I want some time to study those things more clearly. But I want you to pray that I'll be studying those things with an eye towards doing what's right. I can't think of a more honest response than that. That I want to make sure that I'm doing what's right before I just do something. And so we want to honor her request this morning. We have a tradition here that when someone responds at the end of our service, that we will use that also as our closing prayer. So if you would, let's stand together. We'll pray for Rebecca, and that prayer will also stand for our closing prayer. And after that prayer, I hope you'll come down and encourage her. We'll be willing to study with her. Others of you might want to as well. Just very proud of her. Thank you for being here. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we are thankful for hearts that want to do what's right. We're thankful for people who are opening their Bibles, your word. And while sometimes it can be a little confusing here and there, we're thankful that you've told us exactly what we need to do. But Father, we're also thankful for hearts that want to make sure and that want to study, that want to know, so that when they do what your word says, it's for the right reasons, it's from the right motivation. And we're thankful for Rebecca this morning making that statement to us. We're thankful that she's entrusted several of us with some things from her life that she's struggling with as well. We pray that she will seek you in all ways, and that we will be a great encouragement to her as best we possibly can, spiritually first, but in every way that we possibly can. Father, we're thankful that you offer us the gift of your Son, that you offer us the gift of your Word, and you offer us the gift of being able to think and to study and to know what to do to please you, to be saved, and to make sure we live a life that's pleasing to you upon that salvation for the rest of our lives. And we pray that as Rebecca studies, that she will find that, and that we will help her to be encouraged in your word. Father, thank you for the service this morning. Thank you for our guests and for their presence. We're very thankful. We pray that we will be encouraged to do what's right all throughout our days. And Father, help us to do things that are hard but necessary, because in the end, we want to go to heaven more than anything else. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.